When he was growing up, his first interest was chemistry. At the age of 6, he had learned to make gunpowder. But by the age of 12, he had had so many accidents that he decided to change his interest from chemistry to music. He's Frank Zappa. And ever since 1967, he has left an explosive trail of music that has had one constant throughout, biting social commentary. His no-holds-barred sense of humor even includes ridiculing his own audience. Frank Zappa has been acclaimed as a genius for his versatility and consistently fine art under many different guises: composer, bandleader, movie producer, musician, and record company executive. He is my guest this evening. I must admit, I was rather surprised to see you in a very traditional, conventional navy blue suit and tie.
Navy blue suit with kind of a pink shirt, though.
Does that make it all right? I expected you to come in some sort of bizarre outfit, and you look so businesslike and so...
I'm a businesslike kind of a guy.
You are?
Yeah.
People don't think of you as a businesslike kind of guy.
Well, there's a good reason for that, because the only thing that they know about me is things that they've read or things that other people tell them about me.
Mm-hmm.
Since nobody ever gets to see me up close, you know, I'm always brought to you secondhand, and the attitudes of the people who report my activities tend to color the way in which I'm reported.
So what should they know about you? I mean, here's the opportunity for Frank Zappa to tell people what he's really like, so that they're not surprised when they see you appear in a navy blue conservative suit.
Well, I'm a person with common sense, basically, who does a certain type of art.
Common sense, to me, that's always been very important. I mean, I see a lot of people in this country without it. When I was being raised, my mother...
They have them in other countries, too.
That's true. We won't just lay the blame on this country. My mom always instilled in me common sense. She said, I don't care what else to do in life. If you just use your head and you think things out, you'll be okay. I think that was terrific advice. Where did you learn common sense? Or is that something you think you're just born with?
No, I got it by accident.
Yes.
My parents did not necessarily bang me over the head and say, now listen, common sense is really good, because, they were sensible people, but they weren't advocating it all the time. You know, I just learned it by accident.
Some of the things that you did when you were a teenager didn't seem to show a whole lot of common sense. I mean, you got into a lot of trouble when you were in high school.
Well, it's possible to get into trouble in an organized institution simply by being different than the rest of the people in the institution. And if a person gets into trouble, that does not necessarily mean that person is bad.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about some of the different things that happened in high school.
Well, I managed to graduate with about 20 units less than what you were supposed to have because I'd been thrown out so many times. And one of the reasons why I was thrown out is because when I was a senior in high school and my younger brother was a freshman, he was kind of sexually assaulted by one of the shop teachers during a class. And I found out about this during the break between classes, and immediately went over there and held this particular shop teacher at bay with a wood turning chisel and a pair of tin snips, and, you know, did blackboard jungle on this guy, and until the dean of men came in and took me away. You know, but I don't like to stand for people pushing me around or pushing my relatives around. You know, and I get very upset about things like that. So it threw me out of school.
It's interesting though that when that incident is brought up, and I believe it was mentioned briefly, some reference to it in a People magazine article, it isn't brought up why you did that. It only is brought up what you did, and no one knew the reason behind that. I mean, I think if anyone, as they are hearing the reason now, they would say you were well within your rights to do something like that.
No, I think I was well within my rights to go in there and do something like that, but I also think that what happened to me in school was the result of the kind of stupidity that is prevalent in schools in a small town. If you have somebody in the school who is different than the local norm, and we were discussing this before, that without deviation from the norm, progress is not possible. I think the norm is fine. You want to be a normal kind of a guy, you want to drink beer, watch sports on television, and do all that kind of stuff, do it. If that makes you happy, you should.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have other ideas about ways to improve things, new inventions, some new kind of art, whatever it is that you want to do, in a free society, you should be free to let your mind develop to its fullest, and you should receive support from the community for doing this, because ultimately what you do as a creative person is going to benefit the rest of the so-called normal people in the community.
Right. Now, you've had the freedom to do those things. I don't know if you've always felt that you've had the support.
Well, when you say the freedom to do those things, certain things can only be fully executed with finances. You know, if you have an idea for an invention, for instance, and you need the tools and the machinery to build the thing, you may have the freedom to think it up, but you don't have the financial freedom to construct it.
Mm-hmm.
And same goes with artistic projects. You might have a great idea for an opera, but you're not going to be able to mount your opera unless you have enough money to pay off all the unions that have come in to ruin the situation for the arts the way it is in America today.
Now, I'm sure there are a lot of people that are listening and hear you say that remark about the unions, and in the context in which you use it, you said the unions that come in to ruin.
They do ruin it. Absolutely. I think that that's one of the worst things that's happened to America today, is the way in which unions of all descriptions have affected the quality of life in the United States. And the way that unions are represented on television and the PR organizations that they pay and that they have going for them try and perpetuate the myth that America is a unionized country, and when something wrong happens, the unions are there to sort of fight for that underdog working guy. And maybe in the beginning, when there was a certain type of oppression in the workplace, the unions did come in and help support the viewpoint of the working underdog, but what they have turned into is these vast organizations that take money from poor working guys, invest it in shady deals, and don't really help the working people while still feeding them these fantasies that if you all stop working and go on a strike, then we'll be able to get more money for you in your paycheck. But all that does is sort of make the guy that they're working for raise the price of the goods that he's manufacturing, and everybody else bites the bag. But in the case of the arts, I see situations all the time where stagehands unions are paid incredible amounts of money for doing nothing. And in many instances, degrading the quality of the live shows that they're associated with. I see people who are in executive positions in unions thinking up regulations that don't really fit with the way the craft is being run. Like in the musicians union, for instance, in certain aspects of the television business.
And you're a member of the musicians
union. I'm a member of the musicians union. And it makes me feel kind of strange to have to say bad things about a union that I belong to, but I'm forced to join that union because of the way the business operates. And I'm forced to do business with other unions as I travel around and play live shows. But that does not mean that I should keep my mouth shut about the way that they operate. Many of them operate by extortion, and they subject the touring groups to regulations that are ridiculous.
When you say many of them result to in extortion, what do you mean by that?
Well, let's say you want to go to a place and you want to do a live recording at a hall. A guy from the union will come up to you in some places and say, you can't turn your recording equipment on unless you pay us, say, $3,000. And you say, for what? Oh, for extra union fees. For what? Well, because we have to pay this special rate for these men who are standing around here. Well, for what? Well, that's just what the union says. And if you don't pay, we'll start the show.
Would they do that?
Oh, yeah. Sure they would.
Have they paid?
Some instances, if I think the show is important enough to record and there is no recourse, I will pay. Other instances, I don't pay and I don't record. And this happened to us last year in Chicago when we were working there. They wanted to stick us with a $3,000 bill. I mean, the workmen who are at the hall are doing no extra work. I supply all the labor for this recording because it's my recording equipment. I supply all the equipment and the manpower. Why should I have to pay an extra fee to a bunch of guys who are sitting around who care nothing about what I'm doing, will do nothing to help the quality of it, are not putting in an extra second of work or an extra ounce of muscle power? Why should I be bribing them? And it's not just Chicago. There are other cities where...
Do they give you a receipt when you give them that kind of money?
I'm not the one who actually has to shake hands with them and hand them the check. This is something that's done by the road manager. I presume that there is a piece of paper that changes hands when the money is exchanged.
I think probably a lot of people hearing you talk about this, they can understand your frustration. But on the other hand, to say that, to speak out against unions can be considered by some to be almost un-American.
It's not un-American. Remember that not all of America is unionized. The vast majority of Americans are not unionized.
But if there were no unions, like you said, maybe in the beginning they needed the unions, but now they've evolved into something else. But if the unions were taken away, maybe it would return to the way it was in the beginning, and you would have children who were beaten and brought up again.
I would not suggest that at all. What I'm saying is that honesty is the best policy. And honesty in all forms of American business is totally down the tubes right now. It's at its lowest ebb in history.
How do you get it back?
Well, first of all, you have to create a desire for it to be there. And when you have political leaders who do not demonstrate honesty, when you have people lying to you constantly on television, on the radio, in the movies, it's all a lie, and everybody just gets used to the lie as a way of life, then honesty as a concept is very outmoded and archaic, and nobody wants to be an honest guy anymore, because if you're honest, then you're going to finish last, you know, the guy's finishing last. And this is bad. I just think that it's disgusting. I'm 40 years old. I remember when there used to be a little honesty around.
Don't you think there still is? I mean, don't you consider yourself an honest person?
Yeah, but I'm not in a position where I can do anything to influence anybody.
And don't you think there are honest people who are in some of those other areas? You mentioned politics, you mentioned movies, you mentioned television, media.
There's always exceptions to the rule, but I would say, and without batting an eye, that the rule today is dishonesty is the rule and honesty is the exception.
See, I would hate to believe that.
You can hate to believe it, but if you don't believe it, you're a fool.
You think so? I think, yes, in every instance that you have mentioned, in every area, I think that there are a few people who perhaps are not totally honest, or who perhaps are not honest at all, who are dishonest. I don't think that's the norm, though. I mean,
if you're talking strictly about quantity of people being honest versus quantity of people being dishonest, maybe you could come up with a statistic balance that would show that maybe 51 or 52% of the people are honest and 48 are shady. But the few that really control things are not honest, and they count for more votes than the extra ones who might be honest. You know what I mean?
I know what you're saying, but who would those people be?
I don't think we have an honest president. I don't think that he is surrounded by honest people. I don't think that most of the people in Congress or in the Senate are honest. I don't believe that they are honest people.
And why do you say that? What makes you believe that?
Well, I think the proof of that is the way the country operates. And I don't think that most of the people who head up businesses are honest.
See, I would hate to feel that negative. I mean, I realize that unless you open your eyes to a situation as it really is, you can't do anything about changing it. But I would hate to be that negative, that pessimistic about the shape of this country and the shape of the people in this country.
You would hate to be that negative and be right.
Yeah.
That's what would really be horrible. Now, if you could be that negative and somebody would suddenly just come up with all the proof and say, it's really okay, you're just a negative kind of a person. You know, that would be like a cute little dream for a minute there. But I believe that I'm right. I believe they are dishonest. I believe we have allowed them to be the way that they are. We have voted them in. We got them in there, and we're letting them do it. Because we're not honest enough to face up to the fact that we are owned and operated by a bunch of really bad people.
All right, then let's just say that what you're saying is true. I don't totally agree with it, but...
You're a nice person, so you don't...
All right, thank you. My mother thanks you. Let's say it is true. What do honest people do to change it?
I don't know whether they can. Now, that's what really sounds pessimistic.
Yes, it does.
I don't know.
Fatalistic.
No, it's not fatalistic. I mean, you can try, but I don't know whether or not the effort will yield results.
What do you do? I mean, if you are feeling all of these things, how are you able to get out of bed the next day if you are feeling that things are this bad in this country?
Well, I do what I do because I love to do it. You know, I'm dedicated to music, and I get up and I do my music, and I do it my way, and I try not to compromise. Mm-hmm. And if I get a chance to go on television and say this, then I do that too.
Yeah.
And other than that, what else can I do? I'm not about to march around the street with a sign in my hand. That doesn't do anything. you can remind people that something's wrong, because the tendency today is to just gloss over it. You know, the desire for escapist activities is really quite a peak now, and media likes to accommodate that desire. And the more you can escape from how horrible things really are, the less it's going to bother you, and then the worse things get.
We have to break away for just a moment, or things will get pretty bad around here.
I know that.
Yes, we have to have a few commercials. We'll do that. We'll come back and we'll continue this conversation with Frank Zappa. Stay with us. Welcome back. My guest this evening is Frank Zappa. He has been called outspoken. It has been said that his music shows biting social commentary. I think even in the first segment already, I've been able to realize that you have definite feelings, strong feelings about things, and you want people to know how you feel about them, and you want them to take you seriously.
Well, it's not that critical that they take me seriously, it's just so they don't ignore it completely. Or just think about it for a minute.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever found yourself in trouble because of, I know one time there was a lawsuit that was lodged against you because of the words in one of your songs. How often has
there's never been a lawsuit lodged against me because of the words in any of my songs.
So what, didn't the Jewish Defamation League?
The Anti-Defamation League, which is a PR organization, made a bunch of noise in the newspapers. And
about a libel suit.
But there was never was any libel suit. There was none. It was pure nothing. It was just a bunch of noise. There was no legal action.
And over what song did that occur?
A song called Jewish Princess.
What did they object to?
I don't understand what they objected to, because first of all, the song is journalistic. It reports the existence of a phenomenon called the Jewish Princess, which I think is fairly reasonable to do since they do exist. And in the song, it tells what are the characteristics that makes a person a Jewish Princess. And that's all the song set out to do. And it says in the song that I want one. It wasn't negative, and I don't know what their complaint was, but I'm sure they do, but it just baffles me. They accuse me of being anti-Semitic, which is something that always helps them get coverage in the newspaper. They can scream that so-and-so is anti-Semitic, and they get some, you know, X paragraphs. I'm not, and they're wrong, and that was 2 years ago.
Does it bother you when people object to some of your songs? To what point are you trying to get?
Let me tell you the kinds of objections that occur. And the types of people who object, you know, we've already listed the ADL. That was an organized, mechanized kind of objection. You know, phone calls, letter writing, pressure campaign, that kind of stuff. It was a media-oriented event. Sometimes a radio station will get one phone call from one person, someplace, one time, who hears one word in one of my songs that manages to get on the radio and screams they're going to the FCC. Instead of the radio station thinking about how many people who are listening to that station at the time love the song, want to hear it again, and will support the station for playing it, because one person called up and said, I'm going to do this, the guy who owns the station panics out and takes my record off the air. That's what I object to. Because the people who are in favor of having me played on the air and like to hear what I do, they never call up and say, yeah, that's great that you're playing Zappa.
Well, when people feel strongly about something, usually when people feel strongly about something in a negative way, they're more apt to write or call.
Right, but see, if the station, who's only interested in making money, only hears negative things, then their only response is going to be to avoid confrontation with this particular force in the community. Even it's a crotchety little old lady sitting around someplace who doesn't want to hear the word brassiere in a song.
But how often have you taken something that you like for granted? I mean, you take it for granted, it's there, you like it, but how many times have you called up a television station or written to a film company and said, I really like this, this is good stuff?
You'd be surprised. I've actually done that a couple of times. In fact, one time, there was a television evangelist in Los Angeles. I don't think he's located there, but he's broadcast there. is on channel 20, and he's on all the time. He's on 36 hours a day. I can't remember his name. He's got white hair, and he sits there, and he's a real fundamentalist, and he's, you know, real hard sell. And I watch these shows a lot, all the different ones, and I listened to him for one night for about 2 hours, and I thought he was brilliant, and I called up, and I said so. Because what he was talking about at that time, he sounded like one of the smartest lawyers I've ever seen in my life. As long as he was talking about something that was realistic, you know, other than his monetary pitch for his organization, I could definitely be enthusiastic about what he was doing. And I call up and said so.
But see, most people don't do that.
Yeah, but they should. You know, if you see something that you like, you should push it. You should, you know, let the people who have invested the money in the phenomenon know that their money was well spent, so they'll keep spending it on that and not shift the money to some other project.
Mm-hmm. What makes you really angry?
What makes me really angry is the exaltation of ignorance. That really makes me mad.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was telling another person a little while ago that people have thought that hydrogen was the basic building block of the universe because it's so prevalent. But I believe that the basic building block of the universe is stupidity. Now, stupidity has a lot of charm to it, but ignorance doesn't.
Isn't ignorance bliss?
No, I wouldn't say so. Never having been truly ignorant, I couldn't tell you about
really
a blissful state like that. And I've observed a lot of other people who are ignorant. And I wouldn't say that they were in a state of bliss either. They were okay. They were having a good time. I wouldn't call it bliss.
Why does it make you angry, and what can you do about that anger? How can you change it?
Well, I can't change it, you know, but that doesn't keep you from being angry about it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, in what ways are people ignorant, and how should they change it?
Remember, I said the thing that makes me mad is the exaltation of ignorance.
Yes,
you know, when you celebrate ignorance, you know, and make that the national standard.
How is it celebrated?
Celebrated in all records that achieve massive airplay on the radio, all television sitcoms, most films, and most commercials, and also in schools.
How in schools?
Schools train people to be ignorant with style. They give you the equipment that you need to be a functional ignoramus. American schools do not equip you to deal with things like logic. They don't give you the criteria by which to judge between good and bad in any medium or format. And they prepare you to be a usable victim for a military-industrial complex that needs manpower. As long as you're just smart enough to do a job and just dumb enough to swallow what they feed you, you're going to be all right. But if you go beyond that, you're going to have these grave doubts that give you stomach problems, headaches, make you want to go out and do something else. So I believe that schools mechanically and very specifically try and breed out any hint of creative thought in the kids that are coming up.
So what's the alternative for the parent who would agree with you?
Well, remember that the school isn't the only place that a child gets educated. If you realize that the schools are doing damage, and I believe this, I believe that schools do a lot of damage to kids, then you should do what you can at home to help give them something to counteract what's happening to them at school.
You mean encourage creativity?
Encourage them to read things other than what the school gives them. Encourage them to watch things on television other than cartoons. Because I don't believe that television is all bad, and some things that are on are very useful. And give them some support. Let them feel that you as a parent want them to be smart, not just to be successful, not just to be a nice little person, but you want them to develop their thinking apparatus.
Do you do that with your kids?
Sure.
What kind of schools do your children go to?
They go to private school.
A private school.
They used to go to a public school before they started busing in Los Angeles. I took them out as soon as the busing started.
You're against busing?
Absolutely. I don't believe that it's not right. It doesn't work. It will never do the job that it was supposed to do. And basically, it's a way for the people who own those horrible little buses to make money.
All right, so they're in private schools. What kind of private schools? Because private school I mean, can cover a range of different kinds of institutions. It's progressive kind of school?
It's progressive academic kind of school where they learn.
Open classroom?
I don't know what that means.
The children progress at their own speed in different areas.
I don't think it's that way at the school. It's pretty structured.
Mm-hmm. And do you think children should have structure?
Yes.
Discipline?
Yes.
You're a disciplinarian?
Yes.
Are a disciplinarian?
I'm not mean, but I think that unless a person comes in contact with some form of discipline, learns how it works, and can then discipline themselves, they're going to be in a lot of trouble when they finally go out into the real world.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the best way is to be able to discipline yourself, but if nobody sets an example for you, then you won't know what discipline is, and somebody will always have to inflict it on you from elsewhere. It'll be your foreman, it'll be your boss somewhere. They'll have to keep banging you over the head to make you do something. Whereas if you learn what discipline means, you learn that you have to do things on time, certain things just have to be done. You learn that, then you do it yourself, and you have less conflict with the rest of your environment.
How do you enforce it?
Well, the same way that you would train a dog.
Do you roll up the newspaper and swat them one on the nose?
And if they do something on the rug, you let them
know.
Right.
No, seriously, do you think?
I don't think I've ever hit my kids more than once or twice.
Mm-hmm.
Usually I just crouch at them.
Do you take things away from them, like no television? You go to
I tell them they can go to the room. I tell them that they can't have their friends over. Sometimes I tell them they can't watch television. I don't think they really care about that.
Mm-hmm.
But usually tell them that they can't go to their friend's house or they can't have other friends over.
In many ways, you are certainly, I can't call you conservative. I would never do that. But in many ways, you are reflecting conservative points of view as far as raising your children, as far as the way you discipline them. I want to find out how you
roll with that, though. I mean, right. You know, like, just because I'm in the rock and roll industry, okay,
right.
I have certain views that I think are traditional, whether you call it conservative or whatever. That's just the way
I feel about it.
Today, conservative has turned into a really disgusting word because all the different kinds of people who claim to be conservative aren't really. They're fanatic. They're not conservative. They're fanatic.
Let me stop you right there because I know that this is something you feel very strongly about also. So let's continue that thought. We'll break away for a commercial first and we'll come right back to where we left off.
Yeah.
All right? Stay with us. We'll be right back with the rest of the conversation. We're talking about being traditional, about Frank Zappa being traditional, and I had used the word conservative originally. Pick up on the conversation, your feeling about the word conservative and how the definition of it has changed or what it means now as compared to what it meant when you were a kid growing up.
Well, I didn't pay any attention to the word when I was a kid growing up. I mean, I was interested in gunpowder and stuff, you know.
Certainly not real conservative. Maybe.
Gunpowder is pretty conservative these days. The way the word is being used today, it is real wrong because most of the people who are screaming that they're conservative are really just fanatics. And this moral majority religious syndrome, not just to single out the moral majority as one entity, but it is the one that people normally look at. There are a lot of other ones, a lot of other companies in the television religious business that are functioning today. That claim to be conservative, but are really fanatic. They're as fanatic as the Muslim sects that are causing all the problems in the Middle East. They're dangerous, and they're wrong.
But in this kind of, see, that's your opinion, all right? And you have stated it.
That's right.
Okay. You have the freedom in this country to state your opinion.
Mm-hmm. And I hope I continue to have that freedom, and that's why I would not like to see them continue in the direction that they're going.
But you take away their freedom.
I'm not taking away their freedom. I'm saying that they are wrong in what they're desiring to do. When they say that, the only way that you can be a righteous person is to do it by their book, that's wrong. My recollection of when I was going to school is the Constitution says there's a church and there's a state, and they shouldn't mess with each other. And if they do, then that's against the law. Ain't it? Is that the way it goes? All right, when you have a president who has been elected with the assistance, very strong assistance, of fundamental religious groups who put money and electronic technology behind his campaign to put him in there, they're shaking hands pretty good. And obviously now that he's in the White House, he has to help them out because they can cause him a lot of problems for his programs while he's in there. So it's a very dependent deal, the same way as the president is dependent on military and industrial organizations that have supported his regime. But the thing that's bad about letting any kind of religious organization, whether it's fundamentalist, whether it's Jewish, whether it's Catholic, whether it's Hindu, whatever, to get involved in the business of controlling the secular life of the population, that it's got to lead to the same kind of problems that you have in the Middle East.
Yeah, I want to pick up on a word that you used in referring to the Reagan administration. Instead of using the word administration, you use the word regime.
It is a regime.
Why do you think it is a regime and not an administration?
Because administration is almost a benevolent word, you know. Let's talk semantically here. Administration kind of is more positive, you know. It sounds like it's getting something done. You know, regime is a little bit more iron-fisted type, and that's why I would use that linguistic distinction. And I think that the situation that we have right now is a cartoon president who is an actor. The guy is an actor. They should have given him an Academy Award and let it go at that.
Is that a bad thing to be an actor? Can an actor have a mind?
If you are an actor and you want to act, go do it. If you're an actor and you want to be the president of the United States, have something going for you more than your acting ability. I don't believe he has the intellectual substance to back up what he says, because his lines are manufactured for him. He is surrounded by people who feed him information, not all of it good, but most of it bad. And he sits there and acts it out. He's reading the teleprompter. He's a teleprompter president. Take that support team away from him. He's hollow. He's got nothing going for him. He's a smiling, nice guy. He's a nice cowboy guy. All right? Is this what we deserve?
What if people would say to Frank Zappa, he's a musician. How dare he think that he can make these kinds of statements and get away with it? You know, just as you've just said, Ronald Reagan is an actor, he should have stayed there. What if people would say Frank Zappa is a musician and he should just stick to his music?
I am sticking to my music, so there's no problem there. But as far
you're also speaking out on your feelings.
You asked me, I didn't come over here and bang you over the head. But in the case of Ronald Reagan, you know, I think that it goes beyond, it's not me criticizing actors as a species and saying you may never rise above the acting profession and you may never go on. You know, if you're an actor and you know something about foreign policy and you know something about economics and you know something about the military and you know something about something other than being phony, which is what actors get paid to do, to pretend, okay? If you are equipped, go be the president. I don't think he's equipped. The only thing he's got is friends in high places, friends with money, and people who feed him stuff to say. I mean, let's be honest about it.
And a lot of people don't share those views.
They're wrong. That's my view. I think they're wrong. They're being duped. You know, the emperor's not wearing any clothes. The guy's got nothing to offer. He waves, he smiles nice. He's a nice guy, okay? Mm-hmm. I don't hate him. I just think he's not equipped to be the president. He was elected by 17% of the population in an election where people were offered a choice between Tweedledum and Tweedledee, you know, and Tweedledee got it.
Obviously, you feel strongly about this, though, because it's something that you'd like to talk about. I mean, you were invited and I asked you the question, you have definite opinions on it.
Sure. I have opinions about it because I think about it every day. It's impossible to watch the daily news, which I watch a lot of. I try and check up on what's going on in the world. And it's impossible to watch news without having some kind of gut reaction to what's going on. And when I see the pathetic solutions that are being offered by this regime to the problems facing the United States, economic and otherwise, I get very angry because they're the wrong solutions. You know how to solve the economic crisis? Tax the churches. Tax the churches and all the businesses that they own and tax them all the way back to their inception. They should pay their fair share of what it costs to run the country. You tax the churches, you won't have to take the food off the dish of the school lunches. There's plenty of money there. They're making plenty of money. tax them. Nobody in government is going to stand up and say that, and it's the most common sense solution to the economic problem. There's plenty of money owed by those organizations who claim to be religious and who are actually in the real estate business, they're in the supermarket business, they're in the chocolate business, they're in a lot of businesses above and beyond helping people to get to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And these are all very temporal businesses, and they should be taxed the same as the guy who owns a gas station.
We have to break away again. I know that you were raised Catholic. I want to find out exactly where you are as far as religion, organized religion, is when we come back. Can we do that?
Sure.
We'll be right back. Raised Catholic, do you belong to any organized religion now?
No, I don't pay dues to any organized religious organization.
Would you consider yourself a religious person?
Absolutely.
And how do you show that within your life? I mean,
it's not a matter of showing it to anybody. I don't think that by showing your religious beliefs to anybody that makes you a religious person.
And how do you live it?
I live it through my music.
Conduct yourself with other human beings? Do you feel a responsibility to other human beings because of the way you handle your own religion?
Of course.
And what is that?
Well, as an employer, I am responsible for the well-being of the people who work for me, and I take that responsibility seriously. As an entertainer, I'm responsible for delivering the best of what I can do to the audience that has bought a ticket to see it or buys a record to hear it. I have a feeling of responsibility. I take it seriously and I act accordingly.
And what about your friends, your neighbors, your family?
Well, I don't have any friends, and my neighbor is a urologist.
You don't have any friends?
No, I only have, when you're the boss, you don't have any friends.
Well, what about people outside the business? Or?
I don't have any time for social activities.
Mm-hmm. Then who would be your friend?
Well, I have a wonderful wife and four children. I like them. They're my friends.
So your wife is your friend?
Right.
Do you think that's important for a relationship?
Well, if you're not friendly, it's not going to be too fun to live together.
But there's a difference between being friendly and being in love with someone and having that same someone be your friend.
Oh, yeah, true. The friendship is a very important dimension, and I think that a marriage without friendship has got to be pretty dreadful.
Mm-hmm. Do you, when you're not working, do you just sort of cut yourself off from the rest of the world and you're with your family?
Well, when I'm not touring, I'm at home. I live in Los Angeles, but I don't go out in Los Angeles because it's a very horrible place.
And why do you live there?
For business.
Oh, for your business.
And, I just stay home. I have a studio in my house. I do my recording there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. And when I'm done doing that part of my work, I go off on the road, travel around, do this kind of stuff.
I know you're very anti-drug, drugs of any kind.
Right.
How did that start?
Well, I was just never very enthusiastic about drugs or drug culture. And I saw what it had done to a lot of people, musicians that I've worked with, the ways that it affected their lives. I saw, well, since I've been touring for about 16 years, I've had a chance to watch the results of several different phases of popular chemical alteration on the audience as we play. Every once in a while, a different drug goes on the charts, and everybody uses it, and it affects the consciousness of the whole segment of the population.
I remember once being at a concert. It was a Rod Stewart concert, and it was in Chicago. And I remember walking in there and being so overwhelmed by the odor of marijuana that I couldn't breathe.
Yeah, it's pretty sick.
Is it like that at your concerts?
No. sometimes you smell a lot of marijuana, but
do you say anything for the audience about drugs during your show?
There's one or two songs that we do that are against drugs. We have one song called Cocaine Decisions, which talks about cocaine usage among lawyers, doctors, and movie people. Drop a line now.
Cocaine decisions. You are a person with a slow job. You got a fancy, got a go job. Where the cocaine decisions that you make today will mean a million somewhere else. We'll do it your way. Cocaine decisions. You are a person who is high class. You are a person not in my class. And the cocaine decisions that you make today will mean nothing later on when you get nosy game. I don't wanna know about the things that you pull out of your nose or where they go. But if you won't waste it from the stuff you're sticking in it, I get madder every day, cause what you do and what you say affects my life in such a way. I learn to hate it every minute.
Result of that is that I don't give them a lecture on stage. A lot of times kids will try and hand me a joint and I just throw them away.
Mm-hmm. So against all drugs, though, cocaine, marijuana, alcohol.
Well, I make a distinction with alcohol. I'm not a big drinker myself. But the thing about drugs is being controlled substances with specific laws that put you in jail if you've got it. It makes you a criminal when you use it, you know, which gives the government another different type of leverage over you. If they catch you, they got that extra little zinger that they can use on you, you know. Just put your freedom in jeopardy, aside from what it does to your health and what it does to your mind. I believe the government likes to have drugs in the marketplace because it keeps the population in a very usable state.
You really believe there's some sort of conspiracy?
Absolutely. There's no question in my mind that if you follow the pyramid right up to the top, that there's no difference between the people who are importing it and the people who are arresting you for using it.
What makes you feel that?
Does it sound far-fetched to talk about using an entire American community for chemical or biological warfare testing?
Well, not anymore. Doesn't sound far-fetched anymore.
Well, you know that it's been done. Our own government has decided to use certain American cities to test chemical warfare agents and biological warfare agents on American citizens without their knowledge. Just decided to do it because the time was right and the area was right and they did it. And you only find out about it 10, 15 years later. Okay? If the government can do that to their people, there's no reason to believe they're above giving them drugs and collecting money for those drugs being used and having the benefit of the stupefaction of the population as a something thrown in along with it.
Except there are a lot of people who feel the same way you do, so they're not going to fall into that plan anyway, if indeed your plan would be correct.
Let me tell you something. I get asked about drugs so many times. Most times when I do an interview, they always ask me about drugs. And the reason they do is because I'm such an anachronism. I'm probably the last person in the United States who doesn't like them and doesn't use them. I mean, you know, maybe you're a person who doesn't use them. I don't know. I just don't enjoy them, and I don't like what they do to people.
I think there are a lot of people, though, that feel the same way you do. I mean that sincerely.
They're definitely the minority. Because today, doctors get wasted. You know, they go out and snort cocaine before they do open-heart surgery. It's cool.
Oh, I hope not. Or I hope I never get that.
Your lawyer gets wasted.
We have to break away.
They're getting wasted in there. Look at them.
But we've been talking about a lot of things that make you angry and a lot of things, a lot of areas where you are very pessimistic. When we come back, I want to find out if there are any areas where you are optimistic. Okay?
Sure.
All right. We'll be back right after this. What makes Frank Zappa happy? I find out what makes you angry. I find out the things that you don't like about this country or the world or anything else. But what do you like? Where do you have some hope, optimism?
Well, I don't have that much optimism, but there's a difference between having optimism and having things that you like.
Sure.
I like good food when I can find it, but it's getting very difficult to find it.
You certainly couldn't tell by your weight that you like good food.
Well, I've been sick.
Have you?
Yes, I've had gastroenteritis for about the last 8 or 9 days, so I've been living on soup and other nasty things like that. So.
But you're feeling better now?
Yeah, recovering. You won't catch it. It's all right.
No, no, I wasn't afraid of that, but you're very, very thin. And normally people who like food are not very, very thin.
Well, I like it, but I'm not going to just eat anything because it's so hard to find stuff that really is prepared well. In other words, good ingredients put together with the proper amount of time by somebody who knows the formula, who loves to cook, and instills in the food their own joy of cooking, mm-hmm. so that the finished result is something beautiful to eat. And that's hard to find, you know.
True.
You can get a good hamburger someplace, but, you know, good food, hard to find. That I like.
What else?
Makes me happy when I find it. I like good musical performances of anything.
And any kind of music.
Any kind of music. Anytime I hear musicians doing their job right, I feel good. And this is also not something that happens all the time. I mean, not musicians yeah. don't always perform up to their maximum capability.
What else?
I like to smoke cigarettes, and I like to drink coffee, and I like sex. And other than that, if I find an honest politician someplace, I might get a laugh out of that. I've seen a couple of people on television who I thought said things that were admirable, and I mentioned one to you. I said, I like John Glenn, and I was even enthusiastic about Barry Goldwater when he was doing his little number about the moral majority, which I thought was very courageous. Even though I couldn't agree with him on everything else that he says, I could appreciate that. And in fact, even went so far as to invite him to our concert when we were in Arizona.
Was he able to come?
No, he was, I think he was at the ham radio convention that night. But, I when somebody does something that I think is positive, I tell them, I let them know.
Yes. What about your kids? What about their
love
future?
Them.
Yes, I know you love them. What about their future? What do you hope for them?
Well, it seems that my daughter has decided to learn to play the drums. I hope that she keeps up with that because I think that a good girl drummer would be nice.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my sons was interested in baseball. He got to be very good at that. Now he's decided to play the guitar, and I would kind of like to have him be a musician if he...
You would.
Yeah.
Sometimes parents don't want their kids to follow in their footsteps because they found it difficult. They don't want their kids to go through the same kind of difficulties.
Well, I wouldn't want them to go through the same kind of difficulties either, but what's that got to do with being a guitar player?
Yeah.
It's just the joy of being able to plug it in, turn it up, and go, like that. He should have that fun in his life if he wants it.
We're going to have to continue this conversation another time. The time has just flown by and we are completely out of time. I thank